Good morning, everybody. Irit, now I understand that I should be insisting on 30 minutes because I will be speaking on two countries, Ukraine and Russia, which of course have a very different background, conflicting narratives, and intricate history of this phenomena, which is called anti-Semitism. But we'll try to get it done in just 15 minutes. So, both countries were starring in the recent poll of the ADL, and we saw that the anti-Semitism for the second time, basically, in the consecutive years is on the rise in both countries, in Russia and in Ukraine. Paradoxically or not, the leadership of both countries would argue that there is not an, there is not a truthful world in all of this in all of these reports. Both countries argue that they are pioneers in the field of struggling with anti-Semitism. In fact, Russia is often producing seminars and methodology on how to conquer and how to battle anti-Semitism in the world. It's proud that it has surprisingly low level of anti-Semitic occasions and crimes that are related to this field. But let's just go over the few expressions of the people who are extremely close to the Russian leadership. I mean, of course, the president of Russia, Vladimir Putin. Israel wants to relocate Jews to Donbass. It wants to help Ukraine by moving large numbers of the Israeli Jews and other Jews to the area of Donbass, which is now being, of course, in the conflict zone, the war zone between Russia and Ukraine. Who says it? Dmitry Glazyev, no other but official advisor of President Putin, and a person who is also regarded as his close friend. Another friend of President Putin, Alexander Prokhanov, who is infamous for his extreme right-wing positions and I would say fascist positions on minorities generally, not only on the Jews. So this statement belongs to him. The four Jews, the so-called Magnificent Four, and here, of course, he's speaking about the leading intellectuals, journalists, who are very famous in the Russian media, they threaten Putin personally. They want and they act so he will end like Tsar Nikolai II. They want to promote a coup d'etat in Russia. Another friend, the vice speaker of the Russian parliament, Pyotr Tolstoy, just last year. I have to tell you, and this is in relation to turning the Isaaki Church in St. Petersburg into from the museum to the acting church, in which many activists and parliamentarians, also of Jewish origin, took part in the protest about this action. I want to tell you that it's a paradox. People who are grandchildren, grand-grandchildren of those who ruined our churches, they jumped out of this pale of settlement. And now, in the 17, they ruined our churches, and now they feel that they are entitled to tell us what we will do with these holy places. The reaction of the speaker of the Duma, of the Russian parliament, Vyacheslav Volodin, in reaction to these appalling words that were denounced by every Jewish leader, by every Jewish community in Russia, these unbased accusations, where everybody saw his own meaning, everybody interpreted his words in their own fashion. He did not necessarily mean what they think he meant, but what did he think? What did he meant exactly? Yes, this is an open question, of course. In regards to Ukraine, you can mention, of course, the recent attendance of the Ukrainian PM, Oleksiy Honorchuk, of a neo-Nazi concert in Kiev. You can also talk about the square in once Jewish neighborhood of the city of Vinnytsia that was called Yerusalimka, after the name of Jerusalem, under the name of Petlura, another newly found, newly discovered hero of modern Ukraine, whose hands were covered in blood during the civil war in the 1919-1920. The numerous desecration of Jewish graves, the desecration of and the destroyal of Holocaust memorials, this is mostly in Ukraine, and the list is, of course, ongoing. So if we are talking about the recent poll of the ADL, the first thing that we has to ask is how credible it is, not because it's talking about too high of data, but perhaps it lacks some data. If we are talking about the collection of facts, the collecting of proofs, the collecting of evidence on the expressions of antisemitism in these both countries, as I will talk about it now, there is a fundamental problem. Because it derives, first of all, from the lack of trust of the people who lives in these countries, Jews and non-Jews, in police and in all other law enforcement organs. So the majority, and this is the poll that we had that was provided by Levada Center about 3 years ago, most of those attacked would never complain about the anti-Semitic or anti-Semitic incidents that happened to them. If we are talking about, very briefly, about methodology of how do you usually, provide, the database for these polls. So you relate, of course, to the data that you were provided by the police or by some other authorities. So in Ukraine, you legally cannot do this because the Article 161 of the Criminal Code of Ukraine does not directly address at all to the phenomena which is called anti-Semitism. It talks about the attack of people of belief, the limitation of rights of the citizens, any discrimination of the citizens, they are not able to exercise their constitutional rights. The calls for extermination of a minority or dissemination of articles of this kind. So theoretically, the punishment for such crimes, this is in theory, of course, it's the punishment of labor at prison of 2 years, possible prison for 5 years, and the block on having some major posts in the government for 3 years. But in practice, from what we know, recently, until, in the last 5-6 years, all of these crimes are being qualified as vandalism without any mention of any national or religious background. So therefore, if you just, based on this article or based on this legislation, you cannot have any credible statistics on what really happens today in Ukraine. We know that time after time, when these cases are being discussed by courts, that there is a reluctance to use any word that has a relation to Jews, anti-Semitism, as if these people were attacked just for walking in the street. They were accidentally attacked in the bookshop, that was an article that was published by one of the Ukrainian papers in Ukraine. Why they were there in the bookshop? Because they wanted to adhere to the lecture on Holocaust. And this is why they were attacked. But there is no mention, of course, in newspapers or elsewhere. We know that there is a problematic legislation that exists in Ukraine. There are also specific problems in the Russian legislation, although it's slightly better than the Ukrainian ones. But the main problem derives it's from the leniency of the authorities regarding the expressions of anti-Semitism that are made by officials, that are made in the Russian parliament, that are made by the spokesman of the Russian foreign ministry. During the elections, the American elections in 2016, the spokeswoman for the foreign ministry of Russia, Maria Zakharova, imitated a Jewish accent when he was saying, our Jews, they told us long ago that, that this is going to be the result. So implying for the conspiracy, imitation of some Jewish characters, in this regard, it's a specific accent that is attributed to Jews, and not a word on any of that. Two specific incidents took place on the internet during the last year. The first one, it's the reaction of the Russian public towards the incident in Syria, when the Syrian army shot at the Russian airplane. And in just few hours, the internet, specifically the Russian social media, such as Odnoklassniki, the Yandex, various social networks, All of them, they were soaked in brutal anti-Semitic violent attacks against Jews as Jews, against Jews as part of the State of Israel. This anti-Semitic attack that continued for about a week or so before somebody there upright, you know, they intervened and they put an end to it, but it was never ever addressed, not the president, not by prime minister, not by the Ministry of Defense, who actually played not a little role in the inciting and all of that. The other accident, no less appalling, happened in 2018 after the horrific fire that took lives of many innocent children in the city of Kemerovo and in Siberia, where they died of choking and of fire in the cinema in one of the trade centers. So immediately after, and it seems like it was an intentional injection of such an information, accusations of ritual murder, because it was the accident happened 2 weeks before Passover, of ritual murder, of sacrifice that were performed by Jews or Jewish businessmen or Jewish politicians. So such an accusations were just, you could not open, you know, any of the Russian media, not to read the talkbacks, not to see the what is happening on the social media, and just to ignore it, because it was everywhere. Some investigation, dependent investigation, showed that, you know, it all happened simultaneously. So we can talk about the traditional anti-Semitism that grows from the you know, from the feeling of, you know, some devoted Christians from the Russian church. But we can also talk about some elements that specifically target the Jews, target, you know, and incite this horrific hatred online. And this is basically the consequences, that the anti-Semitism, at least in Russia, it traveled from the streets, from the places of work, where Jews were traditionally discriminated during the Soviet times. It traveled online. And as for online, my friends, there is no data. There are no specific researches that would stipulate what is really happening there. Is there a surge? Why are there specific surges? You know, why does it happen? Is it some words that are being pronounced, you know, from the, on the state TV? And there are enough of those words that are just being pronounced and said all over. Or is it something else? You know, who is interested today in disseminating anti-Semitism in a country that, at least according to its own legislation, according to its leadership, they want to battle it and they achieve quite good figures, at least according to their own studies. The same on Ukraine. You know, the background to anti-Semitism that definitely there was a surge since 2014. This is the year when the Russian invasion started and the civil war began there. It's of course the war, it's of course the violence, it's of course the support of the Ukrainian Jews, of the leadership, of the, you know, pro-nationalist vibe over there. But it seems, and there is an excellent study that I would recommend to just everybody to take a look on it, that was written by the Samuel Sokol. It's called Putin's Hybrid War and the Jews. And it talks about specifically about fabrications of pogroms that never happened, fabrications of attacks on Jews that never took place, false evidence, false names, false everything, fake news as we know it. So, first of all, I'm closing right now. I have to say just that we don't know nothing. We don't know anything about what is happening there. We can just appreciate more or less the horror that is basically taking place in front of our own eyes. We definitely have to invest much more into the study of this phenomena in Russia and in Ukraine. And as a State of Israel, as Ministry of Foreign Affairs, as the Israeli Knesset, we have to be, of course, much more active in denouncing such acts, which never happened during my 4 years in the Knesset, during the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Benjamin Netanyahu, who almost always preferred to just not to make any reference to it, perhaps out of fear that it will make issues worse. We don't know about this, but I can tell you for sure that just not talking about this issue will not make it go away.